Good morning and welcome to Church of the Palms. We're so glad you found your way to us today. Church of the Palms, our mission is to love God and love neighbor, which Jesus said were the two greatest commandments. Our prayer is that these two commands guide everything that we do, our worship, our life together, and our service to the community near and far. This morning's service is our sanctuary worship service. Lyrics to the hymns will be on your screen, as well as scripture texts when the message has begun. You can also access our bulletin on churchofthepalms.org, right on our homepage. For those who enjoy worshiping in a more contemporary fashion, there is a contemporary service held on campus. Whichever way you'd like to worship, we hope you can share the opportunity with friends and family who might be searching for a church home. If you'd like more information about any of the announcements mentioned in today's service, feel free to give our office a call or visit us online. Our website is also a great way to learn more about our mission to love God and love neighbor, and all about our small groups, classes, and community outreach efforts, some of which you can attend online. If you'd like to financially support Church of the Palms, there are several ways you can support our mission to love God and love neighbor. One of the easiest is online giving, the options of which you will find posted later in the service. I'm so glad you chose to join us this morning. Now let us prepare our hearts and minds to worship God.
Welcome to Church of the Palms. My name is Sam Wright, and I serve as an acolyte in our congregation. Let us now prepare our hearts for worship as we bow our heads for the prayer of invocation. We come with gladness, loving God, drawn by our need and by a desire to praise you and give thanks. Enlighten the eyes of our hearts that we may be full of hope. Enlarge the circle of our concern that we may see the stranger as next of kin, the hungry person as part of our own family, the one who is sick as a whole individual deserving of our care. Grant us the presence of Christ that we may learn more fully to follow in the footsteps of Jesus. Amen. Let us praise God through our worship.
Thank you. Hunger for our hearts.
hymn this morning, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. The printed hymn in your bulletin is the tune that we're not real familiar with. So if you want to sing the tune we're really familiar with, you may want to grab your hymnal before you stand so you can sing the right tune, number 142 in your hymnal. With all that having been said, we invite you to stand for the call to worship. Come, God is seeking to gather us together like a shepherd searching for lost sheep. God calls us. God reached out to rescue all who have strayed. Scattered, weak, and injured ones are drawn to God. Come above all else to worship and give thanks. Make a joyful noise to the Creator of all worlds. Let us worship God.
Now we come to a time of confession. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us pray our call to confession in unison. Shepherding God, you have called us, but we have not answered. You have sought us out, but we have continued to wander. You have tenderly gathered us together and cared for us, but we have not extended that same care and mercy to others. Forgive us, remind us, teach us, set us free from sin that we might turn toward your love and justice for the whole world. Guide us so that tentative step after tentative step, we may walk in your way. Amen. Let us continue our confession in silence. Amen. In Christ, we are new creations. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. Through the life, death, resurrection, and in the powerful name of Jesus, we are forgiven. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. Remain standing as we say what we believe by saying the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now we come to a time of passing the peace. May the peace of Christ be with you. And the children are invited to come forward for the children's message. Maybe not. Congratulations. Wonderful. Yeah.
Today is a very special day as we get to baptize Jack and Taylor's beautiful little daughter, Reese. And we are so appreciative of this sacrament of baptism because it is in this sacrament that we remember God's love for us, that we are all children of God, and this special and sacred time when we get to have this little child join us in the body of Christ in this covenant community. Well, today is an extra special day for me because I have known the mom, Taylor, since she was a little girl. She grew up in this church, and I have a question for you children. Is anyone here today 4 years old? Would you stand up if you're 4 years old? Stand up if you're 4 years. Come right up here. Now turn around. This is how old Taylor was when I met her and began loving her. You guys can have a seat. In a blink of an eye, she becomes a mom and a wife. And Jack, we didn't know then, but he was growing up down the street at Incarnation. And today, they bring their beautiful daughter for baptism. Our hope and our prayer is that Reese grows and to know more and more of the love and grace of God. And they brought her today, kids, and you know what? She didn't even have a choice. It is just right in line with our theology of baptism that God claims us and loves us even before we can say yes back. So our joy is to celebrate with them today this very first little step of acknowledging our love of God, but knowing that God always makes the first move. So if you would indulge me now in these very important questions, these promises that we make, and we get to start with Jack and Taylor. Do you reaffirm your own faith in Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord? Do you? Do you claim God's covenant promises on your child's behalf? And do you look in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ for her salvation as you do your own? Do you?
We do.
Do you now unreservedly promise, in humble reliance upon God's grace, to set before Reese an example of the new life in Christ?
We do.
And now to the congregation. Do you, the members of this congregation, in the name of the whole Church of Christ, undertake with these parents the Christian nurture of this child so that in due time she may confess faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? Do you?
We do.
Will you endeavor by your example and fellowship to strengthen her with ties with the household of God? Will you?
We will.
And to all of you children, do you promise to give Reese a helping hand whenever she needs it and to share the love of God with her? Do you?
Yes.
Excellent. Let us pray. We thank you, O God, for the water of baptism, for naming and claiming us as your own. In the waters of the Jordan, Jesus was baptized by John and anointed with your Spirit. By the baptism of his own death and resurrection, Christ set us free from sin and death and opened the way to eternal life. Pour out your Spirit upon this water and upon Reese, that she may grow more and more into your likeness, and that she will be empowered to do your will, to share your love, and to be your light in the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we thought we would try this, and we'll just see how it goes. We see if I get to hold you or if Mom and Dad get to hold you. What is the Christian name of this child? Reese Elizabeth Corey. Come on over here with your mom. I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come with me, and we're going to walk around here and show her off while we sing Jesus Loves Me. Come on.
Thank you. behalf of Children's Ministry, our family ministry, we'd like to welcome little Reese into the family of God. Hi, sweetheart. Well, this is how it begins. This is all your church family here. And at church, we try to create a sticky faith, sticky, so that when you leave home, you grow up and you leave home, you don't leave your sticky faith stays with you. So to help you on your journey, Mom and Dad, we are presenting little Miss Reese with her very own picture Bible, your certificate, and a cross stitch that that is right here that we have some ladies that pray for her with every stitch so that you will be loved. You are so loved.
Gracious and loving God, we thank you for your presence in Reese's life. We thank you for your presence in this place and everywhere that we go. May she grow more and more, O God, into who you created her to be, being your light in a world that so desperately needs it. So be with this beautiful family. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I hope you had a wonderful Thanksgiving. It's always a joy to welcome some guest musicians from the Sarasota Music Conservatory. So Mia, thank you. Great job today and keep up your hard work. Thank you. Our Gather and Grow Advent series, God, Bethlehem, and Hollywood, begins this Wednesday during Wednesday Night Live, and then will continue on the following two Sundays at 10:15 in the Campus Center. So please watch before Wednesday. It's a Wonderful Life, and Pastor Steve will lead us in that conversation on Wednesday evening, and then in the following two Sundays, different movies. To give you a quick update on our food pantry offering since November 1, we have collected $10,548. So thank you so much for helping us feed the community. If you want a new best friend really fast, you will come back, go get some brunch, and come back at noon, and Yoko will become your best friend if you decide to come and decorate the sanctuary with us. You don't have to climb ladders. You can just fluff some garlands, do all kinds of things, but we would love for you to come back at noon today, and we're going to make this place wonderful for the holiday season. The tickets are going fast for Messiah. This is December 9th at 4 p.m. on Saturday. Tickets are sold in a courtyard, or you can get them on the Choral Society website. So we hope to see you there. Another way of helping in this season of giving is to ring the bells for the Salvation Army right here at Publix. We've done it many times with my family. It's such a wonderful way to help again in our community. You can sign up on the table in the courtyard today or on the website. Other thing you can get to next week is the poinsettias from the boys, the Cub Scouts, and they're always wonderful. All the instructions are in the bulletin on page 13, so you know how to do the payment and everything, but this is all happening next Sunday. Another way to help in our community is to help with Light of the World, their Christmas extravaganza. We're collecting $25 gift cards for either Target or Walmart for the kids that are 12 and up. Or if you'd rather, you can buy a present value, maybe $15 to $20 for children under 12. And just make sure that you mark what gender and age group on your wrapped present. And you can bring those, all the gift cards in the presents, in the office before December 10th. And you can also decide to go help distribute those. And that would be on December 17th between 3 and 6. That's their big, wonderful festivities there. And you can just sign up with Phyllis Kaiser outside in the courtyard or in the front office. And finally, after you've been giving and giving and giving, you can fill yourself up with our Advent devotional made by us at Church of the Palms, the drawings and everything. It's wonderful. You can pick it up today after the service, and that will help you get through the holidays. Let us continue our worship.
Genevieve mentioned a couple minutes ago that I will be teaching on Wednesday night on It's a Wonderful Life. That has nothing to do with the outcome of the Michigan-Ohio State game.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, fresh from our Thanksgiving tables, we are grateful to be gathered here among your people. We confess that in our season of Thanksgiving, when we pause to consider the inventories of our lives, we think of what comes first and most to mind, the members of our family, the closest of friends, the creature comforts, the abundance of food, and these are what fill our prayers of gratitude. And we do thank you for those things, O God, for you created a world that allowed for these things to be. You created us with minds and hearts that could find joy in the gifts of family and friends and food and feast. Today, though, we gather with the body of Christ who make it their practice to process to sanctuaries and chapels and auditoriums across the globe to lift our voices and to make a joyful noise to you. We worship you for who you are. We come each Sunday to the headwaters of our abundance. We come into the house of the Lord to find here the loving presence of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit who welcome us home each day, each week, each year. We lift our heads and hands and hearts to the author of all good gifts and find our greatest joy in telling forth your praise. And as we join with this chorus of worshipers, we also give thanks for each and every member of the body of Christ. By your Holy Spirit, you drew together different people, people who have arrived by different paths, people who wouldn't necessarily agree on some things or maybe most things, people who see you in different ways, people who serve you in different ways, people with different gifts, different stories, different experiences, different opinions. And yet by your grace, and as different as we are, we all just stood a moment ago and together as a chorus said, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. Oh God, we thank you that when we recite that creed, we show ourselves in the world that we are in agreement on something and someone so vitally important. We have majored in the majors. We thank you for this body that finds so many ways to be shoulder to shoulder and spirit to spirit in our attempt to love you and love our neighbor, an antidote to the world's troubles. So we pray for our troubled world, for our fractured world, this fractured world that has 1,000 ways to communicate and so few ways to listen. So little is understood. We pray for the hostages in Gaza. We pray for the innocents of war. We pray for spears to be turned into plowshares. We pray for political leaders to politicize less and lead more. We pray for prejudice to be vanquished. We pray that you would break our hearts of stone and make them tender hearts of flesh, tender enough to love again our families, our friends, our neighbors, our fellow worshipers, our fellow believers, and especially those we do not know or do not love or do not care about, especially those. For we pray it in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This past Wednesday evening, members of Temple Sinai and members of Church of the Palms, along with many others from the community, gathered at Temple Sinai to give thanks. In a world where leaders and media and candidates and Facebook posts aim to tear people down, a few hundred folks responded by building each other up, joining together and giving thanks. Thanks for each other, and thanks to the God of Israel who has blessed us with each other. Human beings befriended by God and befriending each other. Thanksgiving weekend proves time and time again that the more grateful the world becomes, the more hopeful our future will be. This is why thanking God is the first of our core values, And this is why in every one of our services we have a moment of gratitude. Should your gratitude compel you to give back to God and God's church, baskets are at the doors, and a variety of ways to give electronically are listed on the back of your bulletin. Let us continue our worship.
Gracious and loving God, we long for the time when the meek shall inherit the earth, and all who hunger and thirst after justice shall be satisfied. And we believe that despite the persistence of evil, now is always the time when more good can be done and we can make a difference. May it be so through the offering of these gifts and the offering of our lives. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. be seated. Our scripture reading today comes to us from the Gospel according to Matthew in its 25th chapter, beginning at the 31st verse. Hear now the word of the Lord. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from the other, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. And then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me." And then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, and naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly, I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these, who are members of my family, you did it to me." And then he will say to those at his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick, and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry, or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not take care of you?" And then he will answer them, "Truly, I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Holy God, open your word. Give us a spirit of wisdom and revelation that our eyes might be enlightened and we may know the hope to which we have been called. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. There is more to see than meets the eye. One of my first impressions when I landed in Port-au-Prince, Haiti, was the trash. I was at 42 years old, just arriving for my first visit to a developing country, and what I remember seeing was just trash everywhere. That, and I saw devastating poverty and need. I saw people without enough. What I know now is that leading up to that trip and on my first few days in the country, I really didn't see Haiti or her people at all. Before we left for the trip, my friend Skylar had said to me, "Sarah, there's more than one kind of poverty." And I nodded, sort of earnestly, having no idea what that meant or what he was trying to say. Because I knew one kind of poverty, the poverty that keeps people hungry and homeless, poverty that keeps children, especially girls, from getting the education that might help them change their lives. We were there in Haiti to help lay the foundation on a new primary school, and driving through the crowded streets of the capital city, it only served to confirm my predetermined vision of who Haiti was, of who her people are, and what their needs are. All of this, mind you, without speaking to a single Haitian person. We drove for several hours to the small village where the school would be built, And we met the family with whom we would stay, and I saw malnutrition and dirt floors and no plumbing and no electricity and lots of bugs, like really big, terrifying bugs. And I went to bed just exhausted and quite sure that I had seen what there was to see. But I was wrong. I was so, so wrong. In the days to come, as we worked alongside the community, I saw siblings looking after one another, and I saw people who were so grateful for every little thing. I saw people who were deeply rooted in their faith and full of such joy. And I watched as my host mama, she'd sort of fuss over and care for and reprimand children who were not her own. And I worked alongside a man one day. He was in his 80s, and he had come to help build the school, which none of his children or anyone in his family would attend in a community in which he didn't even live. And my vision, it changed. What I saw changed. It was as if a veil had been lifted and I could suddenly see such abundance, such beauty. And I felt a kinship that made me more passionate about helping the community just as they were helping me in any way that I could to meet the needs that they themselves had identified and shared with me as their sister. To meet their need not in a paternalistic way, but in the way you care for people you know, people who are your kin. There is more to the people of Haiti than meets the eye. And I think this ability to see, to really see people, has to do with proximity. I had to get closer. There's something important about proximity, about drawing closer. I once asked my Haitian friend James what he would do if he had $1 million to flood into Haiti, and he would say, "Well, first, I would ask the Haitian people." In our scripture reading today, Jesus tells us that what matters most to God is that we see and meet the unmet needs of those who are all too often invisible. There is no "as if" at the beginning of this passage, as there was with last week's scripture. There's no "as if." This is not a metaphor. This is how things will be when the Son of Man comes in glory. Our lives will be measured by our care for the smallest, the least of these children who are God's own. And Jesus is talking about food that hungry people can eat. He's talking about visiting actual people in prison. Jesus is talking about really seeing people, seeing them and hearing from them of their need and helping by offering what we have. So then God's reign is characterized in the present, not by works of miracles or powerful works, but by deeds of love and mercy and compassion, especially toward those most in need. On Judgment Day, Jesus will not care so much about our belief systems or our personal devotional practices or all of our good intentions. Jesus does and will care about how we treat one another, particularly the most vulnerable among us. And it is here in the caring for the least of these that we can find and know God. It is here that we can really see God. So then there is perhaps no greater harm we can do to God's heart than to fail to see others. We cannot meet the unmet need if we don't know what it is. And we can't know what the unmet need is unless we draw close enough to see it, to see people, not problems. One of our mission partners here at Church of the Palms is the Heart Gallery. And if you're not familiar, the Heart Gallery of Sarasota works to bring our community's foster care children into the light. I think we all know, of course, that there's foster care and that the system is overwhelmed, and it starts to feel like a big problem to solve instead of what it is. Children. Children who, by no fault of their own, find themselves without a loving home in which to live. We know it's a problem, but we get into trouble when we stop seeing the people. And what the Heart Gallery does, it's really simple. They partner with professional photographers, and they take pictures of these children, and then they blow them up, and they display them around our community. And try as people might, they can no longer look away. They have to see the human being, the child of God, whose unmet need is waiting for a faithful response. These portraits, they force the community to see, to really see these precious children. And what they does works, their methodology works. It's affected hundreds of adoptions in Sarasota, DeSoto, and Manatee County because there is more to see than meets the eye. And when we see these children, when we do what we can to know them, to understand their lives and their stories, we are drawing closer to God. I read a wonderful book recently called Rough Sleepers about Dr. Jim O'Connell in Boston and his mission to bring healing to homeless people. When Dr. Jim was getting started in his vocation, the nurse he worked with, it's a wonderful woman named Barbara McInnes, Nurse Barbara told Jim not to come in with all of his doctor questions. She said, "You're just going to scare them away." She said, "You have to learn to listen to these patients." She understood that when we listen, we see more clearly. In his first week in work, Dr. Jim, he was fresh out of his residency, and he was kind of a hotshot superstar, full of lots of ideas about the poverty he saw, the medical crisis in front of him, and he was going to get to work. He was ready to fix it. But Barbara, she had him set down his medical bag, and she asked him to forget everything he thought he saw, everything he thought he knew about these people and how to help them. And Nurse Barbara, she had Dr. Jim wash feet. For more than a month, Dr. Jim washed feet. There's something to this posture of humility, this posture of proximity that's important, fundamental even, and we can all wash feet in one way or another. Dr. Jim's assistant, Julie, shared that out on the cold and windy Boston streets, when she saw homeless people begging or slumped up against the wall, there seemed to be some sort of invisible barrier blocking all pathways between them and her. That resonates as true to me, that there can seem to be this sort of invisible barrier blocking all pathways between us and them. But at McInnes House, as it came to be called, she found that homeless people acquired identities. She said, "What I know for sure is that there's something about being with someone, and I mean really being with them, not distracted by a cell phone or a computer or intention to fill a medication or fill out paperwork. There's something about really being with someone that dignifies his or her existence." The incredible thing about this passage, about where Jesus directs us in this passage, the good news in this passage, is that this way of seeing others and meeting their unmet need, it's full of simple tasks that we all have the God-given ability to fulfill. Food, water, clothing, hospitality, companionship. These are not only the most fundamental components of our shared life, they're also some of the most readily available gifts to give. Jesus is just asking us to share what we have. How powerful to consider that when all eternity has been reduced to darkness and light, one thing that will really matter is whether or not we fed the hungry. And there is such a need to answer this call. We see it every day at our food pantry. I had the powerful experience of visiting the Resurrection House in downtown Sarasota a few weeks ago. If you're not familiar with it, the Resurrection House is a resource center committed to transitioning at-risk individuals, mostly homeless individuals, to a path of self-sufficiency. Their range of services include showers, bathrooms, restrooms, laundry, counseling, medical treatment, legal advice, food, clothing, veterans assistance, a barber, a post office, and more. I've thought often since my tour about that laundry station, about the sort of simple, holy humility of washing and drying and folding a homeless person's laundry. I'm not a great folder, but I'm thinking I'm going to try to go and do that. While I was there, my tour guides were their interim director, a man named Mason, and their longtime operations manager named Joe. And Joe is a force of nature. He's 80 years old, and he is just a ball of energy. He's full of energy and passion for what they do. He's quick to smile and full of such joy. He's one of those people in whose presence you can really feel the light and the love of Christ. Joe says that while clients have different struggles and different needs, all of them, when it comes down to it, all of them just need someone to talk to. They know Resurrection House is a safe haven, a place they can rest and regroup. Joe says, once I've got them settled in and to trust me, I'll ask them about their siblings and their aunts and their relatives, and then I'll ask them how they came to be homeless. And they often say, no one has ever asked me that. There are populations of people, of God's children, who are struggling to survive in a society that seems to have forgotten about them. They feel invisible. Those living on the streets talk about their daily experience of being ignored, overlooked, or even feared by their fellow citizens. But there is more to see than meets the eye. In his homeless brothers and sisters, Joe sees more than meets the eye. And I imagine that one of the things that makes Joe so grateful and joyful is that he knows and has experienced that God is there. God is there in the messiness and the ambiguity of human life. God is there in his homeless neighbor. If we want to see the face of God, we need to look into the faces of the least of these. Children without people to care for and love them, the homeless, the addicted, the sick, the hungry. My friend told me there are different kinds of poverty, and I think I now understand what he meant. And I think our poverty is believing the lie that we are not all connected. Our poverty is relational. And God wants to save us from that poverty by flooding our hearts with love and by persuading us to allow that love to pour out of us, by persuading us to care and to see, really see other human beings who need us. In a world that often seems too big and problems are too big and too complicated to change, it would seem that our lives, our simple lives, are more meaningful and valuable than we could have ever imagined. Because, friends, the task at hand, it isn't complicated. We have all we need. God has given us all we need. As Mother Teresa taught, we may not all be able to do great things, but we can all do small things with great love. I visited some of our congregation at Sunnyside Village a few weeks ago, and I was really touched to see they have a collection box set up there for dry goods and canned goods, which they then transport here to Church of the Palms for distribution through our food pantry. It's a small thing done with great love. And last week, another member came up to me because our Loving Stitches group had quilted or knit a beautiful blanket for our mission partner, the Childhood Protection Center, which cares for abused children in our community. It's just a blanket. It's a small thing, but done with great love. We can all decide to draw closer to see the invisible people all around us. We can commit to seeing more than meets the eye. We can begin to really see others when we learn more about the lives of those who are in foster care or prison, when we learn more about the hungry or the homeless. This can start with a trip to the public library. Learning is seeing. We can begin to see others when we take the time to understand their lives and to listen to their stories. Listening is seeing. We can really begin to see others when we sit at hospital bedsides or in grief groups or in recovery groups, and we turn our attention from ourselves to the other person sitting across from us. Presence is seeing. We can really begin to see others when we volunteer at our food pantry or in our tutoring program, or we journey down to Immokalee to feed people with Mission Panyel. We can financially support the partnerships and the efforts of our church to care for and see others. We can collect peanut butter, and we can knit blankets. Some of us can, anyway. We can really see others when we engage with those who are struggling under the weight of their need, and we can, as Nurse Barbara would advise, we can just be there with them. We can be present, and if need be, we can stand with them in the darkness. And there, side by side, shoulder by shoulder, we can see beyond our limited vision. Here, we can see the kingdom of God. My hope for each of us this week that we may have eyes to see more deeply, that we might look closer. And now receive this blessing. May you remember your highest privilege. You are known by God and you are treasured in heaven. Wherever you go, God is with you. Wherever you are, God is at work. Christ, who indwells you by the power of his Spirit, wants to do something in and through you. Believe this and go in his grace and his love and his power. And all God's children said, Amen.